The age of intellectualism is dead. And this may or may not be the theme of this video. Before we go any further, we will thank our coaches who know the truth. They're not intellectuals. They know what's true. Coach Jesus, Coach Ramana, Coach Buddha, Coach Avatar Anandamayi, and Coach Neelam, and Coach Holy Spirit, Coach Super Synchronicity. Without these coaches, we would be still enmeshed in intellectualisms, and that's no good place to be enmeshed, actually. It's sort of juvenile in that we prefer to search for truth rather than find it. And that ultimately brings about all sorts of troubles, which we're experiencing right now. So the age of intellectualism is done. It's gone. It's gone. So now we need to find, choose, where we're going to get ultimate truth from. There's lots of different styles of those who profess one thing or another as far as ultimate having answers. And we certainly do that now, and this helps us get over this transitional phase of realizing, intellectualism, it doesn't work, does it? No, it doesn't. That's really the root of our problems in the world right now. It's yeah. And so it's done. We have to move on from it. No two ways about it. Strong draconian systems are coming into place here. And so it's time to say, okay, let me realize that there are answers. Let me make sure I get the right answers. Let me make sure I'm getting the right answers. And so we say just loving, never-ending, perfectioning. Wow, for all of us who are in shock about what's going on. Yeah, I mean, intellectual shock. We thought we could just ruminate forever, And it's just like, no. There was an end to that. And it's like, oh my goodness gracious, you mean I really have to get down to business? Yes, we do have to. So just loving, never-ending, perfectioning. Wow. 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 These bodies, these personalities have nothing to do with what any of us are. Nothing to do with it whatsoever. They're just dream devices, like to register pressure. That was supposed to induce a new type of creativity that we believe can change reality. We're spirit. We're trying to change reality. We can't. And we have this dream, this universe designed to, we hope, develop a new type of creativity. And so we need these bodies that are vulnerable to, they're under constant pressure, life survival pressure. Survival pressure, and we believe that being under survival pressure will produce a new creativity. It doesn't. It doesn't. It never will. So that's an ultimate answer. Intellectualism is just trying to delay, delay, delay. Maybe, 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 maybe. False hope, false hope, false hope, false hope. It's a horrible place to be stuck in, actually. And once you move out of that, the feeling is, wow, this is a lot better, actually, a lot better. And so here we don't have much intellectualisms at all. We have definite answers, very definite answers. And as we go along, more definite answers certainly will arise. I can't just snap my fingers necessarily and say, what should we do? Law and order or criminality? Where do you go on that one? Which is really the dichotomy that is at work. If you cut through all of the nonsense, we're dealing with a situation: is do you go for law and order? Or do you go for lawlessness, criminality? And people have different views on that. I'm not don't have the absolute definitive view yet Okay. I certainly growing up in a culture where law and order was stressed, you're very much used to it. You don't exactly want to live in a banana republic. I have friends from Honduras and El Salvador, Nicaragua. They tell me exactly what's going on down there, and I say, "Wow, that's not good." You know, if you're constantly, under this massive threat, how good is that for you? But we have to understand the whole scheme of this universe is to put ourselves under ma put not ourselves, but these proxies, these avatar proxies, so to speak, not spiritual avatar, but these proxies, these bodies, these human life forms, these survival forms, put those under pressure. And so apparently people feel that this law and order society is not putting us under enough pressure. So we want to put ourselves, not ourselves, of these body minds under more severe pressure, survival pressure. That's what's going on. So we have to look at it that way, and realize it's law and order is a tough sell here, actually. Very tough, because there's always this pressure. Saying, look, we don't have this new creativity yet. We couldn't change reality with the creativity of reality. So we believe let's make a new creativity, and then we can be the ones that actually create reality or change reality the way we want it to be, or fix it or heal it. And so we believe that that's possible, and we're trying to accomplish this. And we need these body minds under survival pressure in order to, we believe, bring about this new creativity. So it's a tough sell to say, hey, let's all be safe here, and law, law and order, nice. People subconsciously they rebel against that. They say, hey, now we want to, more risk taking, more danger, more survival pressure, that kind of thing. Yeah. So it's a mixed thing, because a lot of the people who like law and order, America's actually a place for risk takers, but they want a certain amount of law and order to support their risk taking. People not wearing masks, no social distancing, they say, to heck with it, I'll risk my life, that's okay. So America is a place where the tremendous amount of risk taking, and that's why people love coming here. They want to innovate. They want to innovate. So it's an extremely innovative place, the most innovative place in the world for sure, because people are willing to take, risks is what it's all about. So the Americans don't like being told, wear a mask. They say, I want to live a risk-taking life. That doesn't necessarily mean a lawless life, but an innovative life. And we find that law and order helps innovation in that you don't have to worry about your possessions, your home, the functioning of culture. Things are smooth. You know what to expect. You don't feel under assault or danger so much. And then you can really turn your attention to, inventions and innovations and things like that. That's how it works. If you have a constant battle of survival, like a banana republic scenario, then it's real hard to focus on long-term goals in a safe environment so you can really innovate in a certain way. It becomes extremely difficult. So the U.S. has this history of tremendous innovation, materialistic innovation, based on law and order and stability in that. And the question is, do you want to live in a banana republic, or do you want to live in a law and order situation? Now, but answering this is not so easy for people, because again, we feel like we may need, we need this push. We need to get things rowdy, and maybe to get that new creativity. We don't have it yet. We never will have it, actually. So if you realize we'll never have it, then what kind of culture would you want? Interesting question. Interesting question. And I don't have an exact answer for that yet. So we're still in the undecided. I am, at least, undecided in terms of how this plays out. Certainly we know that increasing survival pressure on ourselves is futile. Okay, we know that it's futility. So you would think that we would trend towards a more safe, but boring existence, but when you take the when you give truth a fair hearing, your life is not so boring, actually. It's very challenging. Very challenging. So I live in a very, very, very safe area of the world. The idea of, you know, crime here is like non-existent. Nobody ever even thinks about it. It would used to be, of course, you leave your car, your door, your house totally unlocked, windows open, your car's unlocked, keys in the car when you go to a store, wallet in the car. You didn't have to worry about anything in terms of your safety and the law and order. Never. And if anything happened, we'd be shocked, you know, say, how could that possibly happen, you know? You walk past a house and there's like the whole yard is full of jewels, you know. You wouldn't think of going onto the property and taking some jewels with you, you know. You wouldn't even think about it. So it's that kind of mentality. You're brought up on a strict honor system that you police yourself. You police yourself. So, you know, the idea of having police or not. Well, in the culture I grew up in, you're trained to police yourself. And so people simply trust one another, and there's very little need for the police in terms of law and order, because people police themselves very, very strictly, more strictly than the police could ever do, actually. But if you don't have that self-policing, then what happens? Well, that's not good, not good at all. Bad. Friends in Allendale Valley, it's an area near here, that very wealthy area, they defunded the police back about, I don't know, 8 years ago or five years, but they defunded the police, massive cuts in the police department, and the criminals simply moved into this area and just in middle of the day, noon, walk right in to the houses with knives and no guns. The guns, the police then would obligate to come, but if you did, if it wasn't a gun involved, they would never show up. They wouldn't respond. So they just tie people up, take everything in the house and walk out with no worries whatsoever. So, of course, the word gets out extremely fast in that community, the criminal community. And this whole area was under siege for years. People lived in terror of their lives and their property and everything. You had no idea when somebody would, criminals would just come in at any time of the day, you know. And no protection, unless you bear arms, you see. So, yeah, I talked to people who we worked out there, and they their neighbor's been hit, you know, all around. They said, man, maybe we're next, you know. It's just horrible. So lawlessness reigned in the Almaden Valley. It was horrible. Wealthy, privileged area, just no police, you see, no police. So people are mobile now. So they moved in from up in other areas of the Bay Area. They found out, so it's this hour drive, you know, from up north. Drive down there an hour, walk into home, steal everything, drive back up north, you know, and then fence the stuff, sell it, get some money for, you know, whatever. The criminals don't think anything. Oh, that's just, I mean, that's the way of life, you know. But to the people in the Almaden Valley, that's just like horrifying, absolutely shocking. You know, just upended their whole value system, and everything is just awful. So, it's living in extreme fear is not a good thing. And on the spiritual path, you're challenging your beliefs, and that's very fearful too. So you don't want to compound the fear by also being afraid that, you know, the home invasions and carjacking. And I mean, we've had some scenarios recently that definitely the criminality is trying to push in here, where people at night just go through and try to open all the cars and take whatever that, you know, I don't lock the car, don't worry about that. They open the car, steal everything inside your car. My friend just had all his power tools, thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. Thieves came in, they go case your neighborhood at night. They checked, he forgot to lock his truck. They stole everything. Tremendous amount of loss, how he makes a living. And this is a really good neighborhood. Supposedly safe neighborhoods. So there's all sorts of criminality creeping in, which makes you paranoid. You know, did I lock the windows? Did I lock the door? Did I lock my car? Is something going to be stolen? They're stealing mail out of the mailboxes and stuff. So how can you really, you know, have a relaxed enough attitude where you feel confident enough to tackle your inner problems, which scare us more than anything? When you have all of this criminality, you're besieged by criminality. How can you possibly do that? Now, fortunately, our police department does respond. It's strong. It does respond. And so there's a pushback. I talked to a criminal, and he says the number of police deterrence is huge. He said, if they think that you're going to call the police and the police will respond, he said, they're not going to mess with you. He says, that's the number one thing that he told me, you're safe because people think you'll call the police. They think white people will call the police. He says, they won't touch you. He says, but they prey on everybody else because the other people are too afraid to call the police. So they know there's no danger, no risk for them involved. Interesting. So we're being trained to not call the police, that calling the police is somehow racist, you know. That's exactly what criminals want. You know, so we're really in a situation where we're choosing between law and order culture and criminal culture. And it's very simple. You don't need to be an intellectual to see that. And that's the bottom line, and that's it. I mean, that's really the choice. So it's an interesting choice. but again, being besieged by external fear is not helpful. Is not helpful. Okay. Because the inner fears take all your attention and effort. I've been able to focus on it because I've lived in a safe environment. I don't have to worry about, I have stuff out here, you know, I don't have to worry about anybody taking anything. I never even think about it, you know. Although, you know, occasionally, you know, the car thing happens. But I hate having to worry about, you know, all that stuff because it does detract. It does detract. So if you want to be derelict, derelict culture means to not give a fair hearing to truth. That's called derelict culture. If you want derelict culture, just have criminal culture. You know, turn your country into a banana republic, and then you'll be very spiritually derelict. It'll be derelict culture, is because you're just, you know, fighting to survive. You know, it's like a dog fight. You know, or, you know, it's like animals struggling, growling at each other and everything like that. It's nasty. It's no fun. It's no fun. It doesn't really help. But if you want to be derelict, it helps with dereliction. Yeah. And a lot of people want to be helped with dereliction right now because they feel that the inner quest to give truth a fair hearing is too scary. It's too scary for them. They'd rather live in a banana republic than take this inner quest to give truth a fair hearing, because it's actually even more scary, because you're dealing with the possibility of eternal discontent. You know, you think I might slip up into the abyss of eternal discontent, and that's just unthinkable. You know, that's beyond horrific. So the risk seems greater. So people would rather risk their lives in the banana republic than risk eternal discontent with the spiritual path. Most people are that way, actually. So it could be the U.S. will turn into a banana republic. It's going in that direction, actually, pretty strongly. I don't see the brakes. I don't see the enough pushback, actually. And that's the way the cookie crumbles. That's the way the world turns, isn't it? That's history. Situations of law and order don't last in this world. They don't last. Then you get situations people would prefer just, you know, the brutal struggle of survival in, you know, gangster land. They prefer it. You know, that's less threatening to them. Isn't that amazing? You better be wise to that. You think it can't possibly happen. Yes, it can. If we give up our willingness to give truth a fair hearing, we most certainly are going to then view truth as extremely threatening to us, and we prefer to distract ourselves from this living in a banana republic, gangster land, where, you know, every shopkeeper is too afraid to open up because they'd be looted. Well, what happens in that kind of situation? What happens is then racketeering comes in, and you get these then criminal organizations that will defend your business for a weekly or monthly payment. So you have gangs, drug gangs, like in El Salvador, for instance, drug gangs running everything. And they offer protection. So if you pay them enough, they'll protect your business. Okay. If you don't pay them, they're going to take everything you got in the business. So that's what happens in a banana republic. The police turn into these drug gangs, racketeering, mafioso kind of situations. That's what happens. And people I've talked to from those places say it's absolutely horrible. They wouldn't even consider going back. So we're headed that direction in the U.S. When you defund the police, you're really funding these drug gangs, is what ultimately happens. Criminal racketeering gangs. Otherwise, businesses can't function. The criminals will just go in and take whatever they want, whenever they want to. No police are going to respond, and they will do that. And then you go to these gangster leaders and say, hey, look, you know, how can I function here in my business? You know, they steal everything. The customers are too afraid to come. He says, okay, pay us, you know, $5,000 a month or something, and I will put out the word, and nobody will touch you. Nobody will touch you. and then you get competing gangs in various areas, okay? And you know how that goes. You look at the landscape now. You have all these gangs in the Banana Republic, lawlessness, criminality world, competing each other. They have the turfs. They say, we own this area, and we have our racketeering covers this area. So racketeering is a huge business, you see. These people get extremely wealthy through racketeering, through protection rackets. And then they compete for territory, and they have territorial fights all the time. You go back to, it's going back to tribalism. So to defund the police is how you go towards dereliction, spiritual dereliction culture. And there's one party right now that may be in power, you know, soon in the United States, who are very much for defunding the police, and won't stand in the way of that. And so it's a highway to hell. In terms of, you're going straight into criminal racketeering by criminal gangs. They'll take over all the cities and everywhere, actually. And then, of course, drugs enter the picture big time. There's tons of money in that. People are so miserable, they feel they need drugs. You get the drug cartels, you know, running so many countries. And I talked to people, you know, in Russia. They explained to me the gangs there. It's unbelievable what happened in Russia, actually. The oligarchs had these gangs, these territorial gangs, and just so many, many. It was just horrible, too horrible even to describe. So you defund the police, and you're already there. Okay, you're already there. So this is a slippery slope that's going on right now. More than slippery slope, actually. We already know how it goes. You know, to survive, people need businesses. They need to function. To function in a criminal environment in those circumstances, you need protection. And if you don't have the police, you're most certainly going to go to these gangster bosses. Okay, they will organize, they'll run all sorts of prostitution, drugs, all the whole thing. We've already been through this in history ad infinitum. It's not like it's not like there isn't a book on this already. You know, history is the book on this. It absolutely happens. You get human trafficking on a huge scale. Okay, you just get just this hideous banana republic is what happens. But many people prefer that because it's dereliction culture, where it reinforces, you know, not giving truth a fair hearing. It reinforces it, is what happens. But that's not good for anyone, because then that just perpetuates our obsession with trying to create a new creativity. It perpetuates our obsession thinking that it's possible, and we don't really get to the bottom of it and say, hey, you know, what's really going on? Oh, okay, I see what I did. It's not possible. I can't do that. And you get clear about the whole thing and say, the universe is useless to me. It's totally useless. I don't need this dream of survival pressure. I don't need this dream of survival pressure. And then that opens the door for us to re-engage our attention with our true home, which is delightful beyond description. Delightful beyond description. You can't even begin to compare it with your survival pressure experiencing. You can't even begin to compare it. There's no basis of comparison whatsoever. It's so delightful. That's what I have to look forward to. But and you too, also, as you're giving truth a fair hearing, that's what you have to look forward to. These other folks have a banana republic to look forward to, essentially. And the other side of the coin, it could, because you have so many people who want criminality now, you could go into a law and order becomes extremely tough, and you have a Germany, Nazi Germany scenario possibly arising also. That came out of, just a complete chaos of the Weimar Republic, the whole, banana republic of the Weimar Republic. It was absolutely nuts, and destroyed the country, and there's chaos. So a party came in, National Socialist Party came in, and then they, brought law and order back to the country and got the country back on its feet, And I guess the situation was so hideous to them that they may want to make sure it never happened again. So they wanted to push this, the strict law and order throughout the whole world, kind of thing. It got out of hand. It got out of hand. So that, could also happen on that things are so polarized right now. I don't think there's any way you get past this polarity at this point. So it's kind of like you got the hangman's choice going on in the United States right now. And so we're not really thrilled about either scenario, actually. I don't see, of course, the United States, I don't see, it's not going to go into like a Nazi-like scenario, because the people are so divided. In Germany, there wasn't that division. The people were all on board, pretty much. So most people are really on board with getting back to law and order from the Weimar from chaos. Here, it's more like there's more people who really want it to be a banana republic than want law and order. So it's not likely there's going to be just a unity, of belief here. It's just, that's not going to happen. So we're just kind of, looking at the scenario without intellectualism. So just say, look, it's this or it's this. You could just, it's not difficult to see what's going on. California got a lot of cities already run by gangs. It's terrible, brutal. And that would just spread throughout the suburbs. It would spread everywhere. It would spread everywhere, everywhere, easily, easily. There are plenty of criminal. And the problem with this COVID thing is now you have so many people who are not going to have any money. And what do? You get into a criminal gang to feed your kids. You get racketeering going. The gangster bosses, it's organized, of course. They give you money because you're one of the thugs, who enforcers, and you get money for your family to survive. That's how it's done. So you tear down the government, you're going into gangster land, and it those who want to tear down the government look like they're winning at this point. We will see, but that it's going in that direction. So very interesting scenario. Glad we were able to look at this, and without going into all these intellectualisms, which cause you to get all foggy and say, "Wait a minute, I can't see anything." Yeah, it's easy to see. It's so again, we're done with the age of intellectualism. There's no time for that anymore, right? That's a luxury. The truth is that intellectualism is a bourgeois habit, okay, where they're bored, they don't want to give truth a fair hearing. Wealthy, safe, bored. What do? Intellectual parlor game. Intellectualism is mental, psychological parlor games. It's just a way to abuse themselves, actually. So we got in this habit, this of first the bourgeois, which of course are those who own property, generate income from passive sources of income, own the fat means of production, own the means of production, which is machinery and transportation stuff, and so they get a lot of money because of that, and they're wealthy and their life is good, and so they get into all these parlor games of intellectualisms and stuff, and then what happens is the petite bourgeois begin to imitate them. You always imitate your betters, so to speak. It's like, and so the petite bourgeois, which are the people who sort of help the bourgeois function effectively, fill in the gaps, do whatever needs to be done, and eke out a living that way. They're not the proletariat, blue collar proletariat necessarily. The middle class, so to speak. They be aped their superiors, the bourgeois, and they got caught up in intellectualism, not understanding. These are just ways, parlor games for the bourgeois to amuse themselves as they're dining on the veranda of some wonderful place. Ah, I'm so bored, you know. It's like, let's just, like, you know, go in circles here, you know, mentally go in circles, and let's just this. Yeah, they're just having fun, you know, just amusing themselves. But the petite bourgeois took this seriously and said, hey, you know, this is like how you become bourgeois, is you become very intellectual. And whereas the blue collars did not, the proletariat didn't do that so much. So interesting. That's what happened. And so you grow up, and many of us grew up thinking that intellectualism was what makes, you know, status, class status. If I'm intellectual enough, I'll be a bourgeois. No, you won't. Do you own the means of production? No. Then you're not going to be a bourgeois. You're going to be a poser. And so what I did is ultimately I just ended up kind of hanging out with the proletariat, because they're not under any intellectual pretensions at all. None. They don't even know what you're talking about. You start doing that. So they just cut right to it. You know, that's it. You know, none of these games. They don't have time for games like that. So this kind of helped me get out of intellectualism and realize that wasn't it. That wasn't leading anywhere. That's not designed to get to the truth. Not at all. It's designed to avoid getting to the truth, yet amuse yourself by your avoidance. Yeah. So, there you have it. This is interesting, isn't it? Yeah. So we really don't have time to amuse ourselves with these intellectual games and posing and all this stuff. That's, you know, it's not the time for that. It's not the time for that, you know. Maybe, you know, some other place in time, right? not now. Not now. It's the wrong place and wrong time for intellectualisms. So here we do have this, you know, real strong work ethic. Like the proletariat, you know, blue collar, you go, you work every day at this, you make progress, you get your job done in what? Giving truth a fair hearing. You make sure you give truth a fair hearing every single day, big time. No fooling around. People I work with, they work hard, you know, the blue collar proletariat, they work hard. They come and they work hard. Every day it says, like, I gotta just, you know, get so much stuff done. Have to. You're under so much pressure. Serious, you know, about that. And so they got no times for this idle games, intellectual games. None. No way. No way. So it keeps me very sober. And you got to stay away from all the spiritual intellectualisms. That's just game playing. That's just game playing. No, they're not really getting to it. Have they gotten to the truth that the universe is entirely useless to us and totally needless? We don't need it at all. We don't need it at all. We've never needed the universe at all. Not even for one instant have we ever needed it. And we'll never need it. We'll never have a need for it. Why? Because reality is perfect. So we don't need to change reality. However you want to say change, fix, heal, recreate, you know. We don't need to do any of that. It's perfect. Perfect for us, flawless, flawlessly delightful for us, never-ending perfectioning, wow. So we don't need the universe, period. We've never needed the universe, period, okay? And yet we also don't have a need to get rid of it just for the sake of getting rid of it either. If something's useless, that doesn't mean we have to take it to the dump, right? We could put it in a side yard and say, well, I'm never going to use you again. But for old time's sakes, I might like to look at you and say, oh, yeah, I remember I used to, you know, play a little bit. But it, you know how it is like with toys, children's toys. They like to keep them in the closet for a while until a certain stage where finally they say, oh, you know what? I think I'll take that to the dump. I don't really want it around anymore. But before that point, you don't, even though you're not going to use it anymore, like you're not going to use your tricycle anymore, but you kind of want to just keep it around for a while. That's how it is with us. So we could see the universe is completely useless to us, utterly needless, you know, no need for it at all. And yet we can keep it around for a while. person, you know, for, and so we could still say, okay, and yeah, that's not a problem. It's just like a little toy in our side yard, in our closet, so to speak. Oh yes, the universe is still here. Okay, that's all right. It doesn't affect me one way or the other, actually. it's sort of like that, actually. So the visioning of reality-ing that we can have here, the universe is like that tricycle in the closet, a little something I'm not going to use anymore, really. But, you know, for the sake of communicating with others, I know others still feel they need it. So it's still going to be here for others. It's just for me, it's I'm not going to really feel any psychological engagement with it whatsoever. And yet you can still see it. It's just a beautiful, you know, play of light, so to speak, gentle glory everywhere, and still function here fine. It's just no psychological engagement. It's not needed. It's not useful. There's nothing there. There's no there. So psychologically, it's just, again, no engagement with it. So that's what we're aiming for. Now, in terms of most people, still the question is, you know, what kind of world am I going to be living in? In terms of, is it going to be law and order or criminality? And that's, you know, that's a big issue, isn't it? So we're not ignoring this issue. You know, it can't. You know, I don't think it's wise to ignore this issue, actually. And we're not, obviously, here. So we're sort of just getting some context and some familiarity here. And the key is, you know, we have to step beyond intellectualisms now, realize the root of intellectualisms is just, again, amusement, parlor games for the bourgeois, the wealthy. The aristocracy used to do it, right? But then the bourgeois really became the power brokers in the world. And aristocracy was largely just a symbolic in many ways. And since then, it's the bourgeois who've been setting the tone for society, thinking that this is, you know, high society. This is what, you know, and so we tend to study it and think, okay, how can we be like them? And this intellectualisms and all this stuff, the psychotherapy, all this stuff, this is amusement. Passatiempo, passing the time, staying amused, trying to keep life interesting. You know, it gets pretty boring, actually, for anybody here when you got wealth, safety, wealth, beautiful home everywhere, beautiful garden. You know, you don't have to work, and you could just dine out every day. Yeah, because the wealthy get very bored. Ennui, it's called. It's like, bourgeois ennui, and so they start. Try to like make a big kerfuffle about anything. It'll get intellectual, and they'll take something that's simple and make it complicated. You know, they love to make what is simple complicated, just so they don't get too bored. You know, pass the time, and it becomes a way of life. And so then people again have been aping that, trying to be like that, and say let's make spirituality complicated. You know, that'll be interesting. But that's not the point. Giving truth a fair hearing is we actually have to accept how simple it is, how simple it is, how simple it is, how simple it is, how incredibly simple it is, how incredibly simple it is. That's giving truth a fair hearing. If we keep thinking that truth is somehow complicated, we haven't given truth a fair hearing at all, not at all. And so there's way too much intellectualism still at play. So Ramaharshi would use silence as the best teaching, because at that time, of course, the many who came to him, you know, India had its bourgeois class too, believe me, spiritual bourgeois as well, and they were very steeped in spiritual intellectualism, very, very much so. Terrible habit. And so Ramana found the best way to respond was silence to a lot of them. And what that did was it cut through their intellectualism, you see. It cut through it. It didn't feed it. You know, all they wanted to do was play games with him. Spiritual games. They're very clever at it, you know. They're the Indian spiritual bourgeois of India. The most clever people in the world, maybe, about spiritual games. They could ask a lot of minute, you know, stuff and then relate it back to the rishis and the Vedas and then this teacher and that teacher and this deity and that deity and these rituals and this rituals. And they could just go on endlessly with all these amusing questions, amusing themselves. You know, they're just amusing themselves. They're bored. They're too scared to look at truth directly, you know. They don't want to risk eternal discontent, you know. So, but they want to keep up appearances like, you know, I'm this high class, you know, I'm high class. This is what we do. We're so intelligent. We're so smart. And the people are in awe of them. You know, look at all these questions they're asking. And Rabbit, of course, saw right through it all. So he'd just be silent, just silent. Now, here, at this right now, we don't quite have that degree of trouble. He really got, you know, you know, hammered by that ceaselessly. Everybody came to him, was trying to put on spiritual airs, you know. Well, really, you know, just, I'm going to ask him a really sophisticated spiritual question, you know. So, you know, this bustling bourgeois came to see him, right? I mean, who could be traveling around the world with all the time on their hands to hang out? Let's go to Theravada Malaya. Let's hang out at Raman Ashram for like a couple months. Oh, yeah, okay. And then we'll go to our other home up in the hill country. And people from around the world, who has the money to just, to do that, you know, back then. The bourgeois, of course. A lot of them, yeah, yeah. And so they said, Ramana, I have this question, you know, what do you think about this and this? And they wanted to seem to be really, really like, you know, hey, let's, maybe this will be amusing for me, you know? And he, and oftentimes he's just, you know, quiet. And meaning it's perfectly simple. Okay, keep it simple, stupid. You know, keep it simple, stupid. And for those people, that was the best teaching. Keep it simple, stupid. And for, you know, who knows? For some of them, it may have like settled in. Maybe for some, not so much. They have to keep up their class airs. You know, it's difficult being bourgeois. You know, you have to keep up the game. So here we're not really tormented with that as much, actually. Of course, most people don't even ask any questions at all, right? They're just like, okay, right? So they're not into intellectual isms and airs of this and this and that. It's just, realizing that here we're going to the, you know, going to the real simple truth of it all, which is, again, easy to say. We, as spirit, we're the induced creativity of reality. God, the prime creator, is the will and the omnipresent, impartial, always on this yesing light that will say yes, creatively yes, yes, and support, totally support with this light. The light will totally support any idea at all. So that induces just an endless stream of ideas to be experienced. Automatically induces it. And that those ideas, we'd say, is spirit. Spirit is like that which is choosing ideas to experience, so to speak. But then spirit said, hey, you know what? How about the idea of like reversing the direction of creation? You know, how does that play out? Well, it doesn't really play out because that can't happen. You know, it cannot be these induced creative ideas being the ones that induce the will and the omnipresent, impartial, always on this yesing light. This induced creativity cannot be that which is inducing God, the prime creator, the will and the omnipresent, impartial, always on this yesing light. It can't work that way. You can't reverse the direction of creation. So in getting in this idea didn't play, you know, didn't play. So he said, uh-oh, something's wrong with reality. What's going on here? We got to fix this. We got to fix this. And so then we came up with a design that basically had to design in this survival pressure, hoping we could induce a new type of creativity, which would enable us to reverse the direction of creation or fix what's wrong with reality. Same, you know, pretty much the same difference, right? We're trying to do the impossible. So we're trying to induce a new creativity that will accomplish the impossible for us. That's why we designed this universe. That's why we designed these survival pressure life forms. Just for this. That's all it is. That's all this universe is. And we're hoping it'll work. Because we think if it doesn't work, we'll be faced with this unsuitable reality. Some reality doesn't let us play with ideas. You know, no, that's not true. We could, this idea, it has no play to it. Changing reality is an idea that has no play to it. That's how, the play is no play with this idea. The play is no play. That is the play. And once we get that, that the play is no play, okay, we can let go of this idea. We don't have to try and make it induce some sort of new creativity through these, through survival pressure. But for those who have no clue about this, they think they need survival pressure, you know, until they get this new creativity, and they're not getting, they're a long ways from getting it, so they need a whole lot more survival pressure, need survival pressure, you know, like that. And then, so, hey, welcome to the Banana Land. You know, maybe they'll rename the USA as Banana Land. Probably, yeah. Definitely will rename it. Yeah, United Banana Republic, something like that. The United Banana Republic. Formerly known as the USA. And yeah, we could joke, but it's gallows humor, you know. So, going to get direct answers is where we have to go, and then we'll see how fortunate we are that perhaps the survival pressure will be taken off our necks. You see, perhaps the survival pressure will be taken off our necks. That whole thing in Minneapolis was basically law and order saying, "Look, you're not." To the criminals, look, you're not going to run this place. We're going to run it. We're going to stand up to it no matter what it takes. We're going to insist on law and order here. And the criminal element said, no, we're going to insist on criminality. And who won that battle? Criminals won the battle. No more police force in Minneapolis. Well, welcome to Gangsterville. Welcome to Gangsterville, in the United Banana Republic. And so it's already happening. It's already happening. People are, the mayors can't defund their police force fast enough. Now in San Jose, our mayor said they're not going to do that because the disaster with Almaden Valley. Okay, they already know how bad that goes. It goes terrible. but you know, that's easy to say that, right? As the pressure mounts, you know, criminal, you know, make a, you know, The desire for criminality, for survival pressure, for enhanced survival pressure is very strong in the world right now. Because intellectualism let everybody down. You see what happened? We got caught up in the belief that intellectualism somehow is going to be the answer. And it turned out, of course, just be a parlor game of the bourgeois. As is Marxism. I mean, Marx had extreme class envy of the bourgeois. He's petit bourgeois. And so he desperately played all these parlor games, like tried to imitate their intellectualisms, you know, and made this all this fantasy land of a perfect society. We need to do this and blah, 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 blah. Just amusing himself. One sec. So we're in the times when we realize that intellectualism has failed. It absolutely failed us. And most people have no out, you know, what's next? All they could think of, well, you know, severe law and order or criminality. I mean, what are the other, right? They don't have anywhere else to go. Fortunately here, we do have somewhere else to go. Very fortunate. But by design, by working at it, actually. And so we don't need to rely on intellectualism. We don't expect that to solve come up with any answers, actually. And so we actually have done the work of giving truth a fair hearing, which is what we're supposed to be doing here. We're not supposed to be playing intellectual games in this world. We're supposed to be giving truth a fair hearing. Intellectual games, that's still dereliction, And so that dereliction now, we're experiencing the dereliction of that. People realize that that doesn't work. What do we do now? You know, right? And so really polarizing into a terrible situation. And so we're part of the resolution to that for sure. But the people really are not so ready to, you know, most people are not ready to do that. Yeah, they don't see it as an option, but hopefully more and more will see that as an option, that giving truth a fair hearing is the right option for us, okay? And within that context, everything will settle down, okay? Everything will settle down. So when you have a dharmic culture, which is duty, our true duty, which is to give truth a fair hearing, everything settles down. You know, we don't have to impose a draconian police state, and we certainly don't need racketeering taking place in criminal drug gangs, et cetera, et cetera. It settles down, and people realize, okay, we'll let those who know, you know, who know that it can be done and it's safe, we'll let them organize culture, society, and let's everybody calm down here, and let's get to our duty here. Let's engage with our real duty here, and then it all runs well. It all runs well. So we can't really say, you know, do we want a strict law and order culture or a criminal culture? It's like neither. We want a dharma culture. Now, you know, how's that going to happen? Well, you know, the thing is that we've run into situations like this in the past, right? I mean, Guru Rinpoche, Paba Sama of Tibetan Buddhism, when he was brought in, it was a crazy time in the large area we call Tibet. It was a huge area, huge. Criminality was just horrible. It was a super racketeering scenario there. And he got it started, and then it collapsed and went into like about a 100-year period where it was just horrible. And the Dharma was attacked and destroyed in every which way. But it came back, and they were able to reestablish it and get it going after that period. And then people settled in and began, you know, paying attention to their duty. And it went pretty well. Exceptionally well in comparison to a lot of other places and times. So there's a really good example of that through intervention, through Dharma protection and protectors, and intervention by those who know exactly how to help out, then things can settle down, culture can settle down and get to business. But right now, it's very polarized, very, very polarized. Okay, I'm getting a call here. All right, so that's enough to consider, isn't it? And from this context, we should be able to continue to move forward here with ever more clarity. And we certainly will. And realizing that that we're aiming for this Dharma option. And letting that happen, focused on allowing that to happen. And when you know, get more you know about your duty, the more culture settles down. You say, okay, that, you know, I don't want to do that. That's not right. You get laws, Dharma laws. This is how you have to behave. Okay, you need to behave this way. Okay, you know. And so you police yourself. People police themselves. And turn away from turbulence and undue survival pressure. Turn away from that. So that has to happen somehow. And so we are most definitely aiming for that. And who knows, it could happen very soon. Hopefully so. Okay, that's it for this one.